we'll close that door and we'll get started. All right, we'll go back on the record. It's 10:55. You may begin, Mr. Buckley.
Officer Miles, I have a preliminary matter I need to take up.
Okay.
In his argument, Mr. Chaffness referred to a document that's attached to his group, the brief, as Exhibit 1.
Right.
As you know, this morning he was afforded an opportunity to reopen the record. He was afforded an additional opportunity to identify any additional documents he wanted to put in the record.
Let me just stop you.
Thank you.
That evidence that happened post-hearing is not before this board. I understand it's attached to his brief. I'm specifically instructing the board not to consider the same because it is evidence that was induced after the date of your hearing and after the date that the decision was made by the commission, so it couldn't possibly have been considered by the decision maker. While I understand why he submitted it and don't fault him for it, I don't believe it would be proper evidence before this court. So,
and likewise, any argument he gave would be improper. Because the argument is
I wouldn't necessarily say it's improper, I would just say it's irrelevant. I'm ruling it's irrelevant.
I didn't mean to suggest improper. You're correct.
It's irrelevant. Words. Irrelevant. It's not before this court.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. 10:56. You have 1 hour.
Thank you. Members of the board, Mr. Miles, counsel, Mr. Chance, I'm pleased to be before this board again. While I'm not necessarily surprised to report this, Mr. Chaffness and I disagree about the reasons the Superior Court has remanded this case for your consideration. I would submit that the board should approach this oral argument in the brief submitted based on the proceedings already convened before this board and based on a review of the totality of Judge Bagley's order remanding the case. It strains credulity for anyone to argue that this board, with its experience and background, did not admit evidence many times over objections with regard to pretext or consider pretext in its ruling. What we are here about is essentially a remand that comes with several points made with it that buttress and support the argument that I'm going to present to you. I'd submit that if you look to the totality of the record, in our brief, I quoted the several times that hearing officer Miles, over my objection, of course, allowed evidence on the issue of pretext. And I think it's worth it to just take a gander at a couple of those because it's interesting that we're being told that this board didn't know how to evaluate pretext or handle it. And I point out that the Superior Court did not say that. What the Superior Court said is that, and it commended this board in several places with respect to the actions it did take, and sought a clarification with regard to this sentence that keeps getting quoted back to the board. You heard argument today about seeking to educate the board on its role in evaluating pretext. This sums it up pretty well. Very often in civil board cases, there is an alleged pretextual termination and there is concurrent jurisdiction. What this board does have power to do and is going to do is we're going to hear the case that is related to Mr. Chance's termination and his appeal related thereto. The background that led to the open records request that discovered these emails and those emails themselves are relevant because that's what I anticipate the county is going to intend, and if I'm wrong, we'll see evidence if it serves as the basis for the termination decision. And when we get to your case, Mr. Chaffness, if Mr. Chance, and I'm speaking hypothetically, if he gets on the stand and says, the real reason I was terminated is because I made a decision on the United Recycling Cup and Mr. Laughinghouse didn't like it and he was out to get me, I'm going to let him testify to that statement. I'm going to let him testify to that. We're going to see if there's any other corollary proof that would back up that statement. Probably a better quote, what lawyers like to read long quotes, is at page transcript volume 5. It's interesting in an employment civil appeal, we're citing not just pages, but which bound transcript this body held. Your whole case is pretext. We sat here for 9 days, gentlemen and lady, and heard volumes of evidence about pretext. And now it's being dressed up as this new issue that somehow you didn't understand. You didn't know how to deal with pretext. You didn't understand it, even though, and I'll count them, there are seven different places where hearing officer Miles pointed out exactly what pretext is and that it was part and parcel of what you were to evaluate. I put it to you, if we weren't about pretext in that 9-day hearing, which spanned a month, we'd only been here for half a day. Because it's clear, and it's already been tread, that this man violated several significant policies. And there's this whole numbers game, and even the Superior Court says the numbers don't really tell the tale. It's really a matter of, do you find that there was a legitimate termination and discipline afforded under all the circumstances? It's interesting that we're looking at a record that the board gave the appellant every single reasonable opportunity to submit evidence of pretext, but he forgot something. And this board had the wisdom to cull it out of that 9-day record. He forgot that leaders who violate policy repeatedly and who by their own admission fail to enforce policy should be removed from their position. That's true regardless of whether the person who unearthed the violation was an unwitting friend or a political foe. As I pointed out in my brief, one wonders when an open records request is filed by someone who is friendly to the person involved. If Mr. Chance and Mr. Chaffness would be to heard, if an open records request is filed by a political foe, then the county must adopt a policy to disregard anything that they find in responding to that open records request because it's tainted from the beginning. I put it to you that if there's a problem with how the Open Records Act requests work and how often they can be made and who files them, that, ladies and gentlemen, is not what this hearing was about. And that's what their problem is. But they also have a goal of seeking reinstatement. This board looked at all of that evidence. The county submits the best indication of why we're here can be gleaned from a review of the Superior Court's order. The Superior Court didn't merely rule that this board neglected the issue of pretext. That would have been quite easy. First of all, Mr. Chaffness says that he talks about how when the hearing opened and he presented his argument and I was asked that first question and said, and the Superior Court said, isn't part and parcel what a civil service board is supposed to do to be evaluate whether the reason given for a termination is a pretext for some other improper reason? He didn't tell you my answer. My answer was yes. And I said that has been done in this case. Whether this sentence is one that he doesn't like how it's phrased doesn't support otherwise. And this is important. What he said is, I told the Superior Court to take that record and rule as a matter of law that this was a pretextual termination. He said we didn't even have to come back here because all of your findings support that. The Superior Court didn't take him up on that invitation. The Superior Court remanded this case, and these are quotes. Judge Bagley remanded the case and specifically pointed out, the court is mindful that a lengthy civil service hearing has occurred. He didn't have to say that. He pointed out, this record, this gentleman was given a full opportunity. He also said, the court does not require the civil service board to reopen the evidence. He didn't have to say that either. He could have remanded it, just said, I'm not satisfied with this. He could have directed that the record be open. He had the power to do that, and he didn't do it. But he didn't stop there. He said, there's no evidence that the officer improperly limited the scope of testimony or other evidence concerning an alleged pretextual firing during the hearing. But he didn't stop there either. What he said was, to establish pretext, Chance must prove that the proffered reason was not the true reason for the employment decision. I could cross-reference quotes from Officer Miles during the hearing, but that was exactly what Officer Miles was saying about pretext and why it was relevant, why my objections were overruled, basically why we were here 9 days before. He didn't even stop there. He said, that said, Chance faces a high evidentiary bar and evidence that only suggests discriminatory intent is by definition circumstantial. If a plaintiff's evidence is circumstantial, courts apply the burden-shifting framework from McDonnell-Douglas. And he goes on and he said, if the employer proffers an explanation, the burden shifts back to the plaintiff to prove by a preponderance of the evidence that the defendant's explanation is merely a pretext. A claimant cannot establish pretext simply by demonstrating facts that suggest discrimination, but must specifically respond to the employer's explanation and rebut it. A reason is not pretextual unless it is shown both that the reason was false and that the discrimination or retaliation was the real reason. I submit, gentlemen, that that is exactly what we were about last year. That we are back here with these quotes and these suggestions from the Superior Court is for clarification. We are here for clarification. Now, I did argue that it wasn't necessary because when the phrase "this board" talks about the motivation of the investigation and the discipline, and then talked about its lack of jurisdiction, the best evidence of what it meant by that is by your own hand. The board said we lack jurisdiction to right the wrong, but what it did was it filed the ethics complaint against Brant Meadows, and it said, "The Forsyth County Civil Service Board has neither the power nor authority to prosecute this complaint on behalf of the victims of Meadows. However, the Forsyth County Civil Service Board has the duty to report the evidence brought before it to the Board of Ethics for such investigation and findings that the Board of Ethics deem proper and in accord with the ordinance. This board will cooperate in providing access to all its records from the chance hearing before the Board of Ethics," and it's signed by all three members. What that tells us is that the board, looking at all that evidence and many of the questions posed directly to Mr. Meadows and others, thought that something was afoul in how Mr. Meadows conducted himself. And that even if those political motives were wrong, that the limit on what the board could do insofar as Mr. Meadows was what it did. And that's what that statement meant. Read in the totality and read in the context of the remand from the Superior Court, that's exactly what that sentence meant. It meant what you said on the motion in limine and what the judge agreed with at the Superior Court, that evidence of pretext would be admitted even over my objections. And effectively, what has also been said is that this board, and this is a telling tale, every time something goes wrong for Jeff Chance, whoever doesn't do things his way is part of a conspiracy. Now let's talk about that for a minute, these emails that came in today. I won't talk about the timing, and we've explained that, but I submit it to you, when you look at those, there's nothing new under the sun, as they say. This email, the first one, has to deal with Jeff Chance saying, "I get 3 days according to state law to produce materials requested under the Open Records Act." You heard lots of testimony about that. You heard Jeff Chance admit that he handled that wrong. He said in the hearing, in hindsight, I wish I had handled that a little differently, but what's happened, that's what happened, and the next thing I knew, I was getting a call from Ken Girard. All of what's shown here is all of what you already knew, that there was bad blood between Brant Meadows and Jeff Chance, and that Jeff reacted harshly. There was a lot of screaming, bad language used back and forth, "I'm gonna get you," "No, I'm gonna get you." We spent days on that. So there's nothing. May I be allowed to proceed without argument?
Yes.
There's nothing new in here. What is not in here that you heard, though, is this new allegation that two more commissioners were, quote, in on it, in on the conspiracy, simply because they are shown as recipients of an email from Brant Meadows saying, "This is the kind of response I'm getting from this guy. He needs to take a vacation." Right, we're supposed to, and that's all they wanted to put in the record. They had the right to ask you to reopen the record, let them examine these witnesses. They could have called these witnesses who voted in termination before, and they didn't do it. They want you to glean from this, they received this email, therefore they're in on it. This from someone who said throughout 9 days of hearing, "Well, just because I got an email doesn't mean I read it. Just because that was sent to me doesn't mean I violated policy." But when these two gentlemen receive an email from Brant Meadows, one, with no further explanation, you're supposed to craft a whole new theory of responsibility on the part of the county because of that. That's ridiculous. You can't do that. If that's their theory, they should have sought more to put more evidence in. They simply haven't carried their burden. They're trying to use smoke and mirrors, and they're trying to use leverage to say, if you're not part of our camp, you're part of the problem. These two gentlemen get an email from Brant Meadows, now they're in on it. This board doesn't rule properly. Well, what is said is, the problem is that at some point between the beginning of this hearing, the civil service hearing, and the time when the board actually rendered this ruling, either the hearing officer or the board, or possibly both, lost their political courage. That's the argument that's made by Mr. Chaffins.
And it's an obvious due process violation for the Civil Service Board to ignore its own policies and relieve the county from a crucial part of its burden of proof. It's clearly a due process violation for the board to consider pretext claim in all other cases, but arbitrarily refused to do so for Jeff Chance. And finally, it's no reason for them, being this board, to turn coward and say, well, we can't do anything about this. It's exactly what their job is, and they fail to step up. No offense. We're not family, and I'm not related to y'all, but I find it offensive as an officer of the court that what we're hearing is that y'all just don't know what you're doing, and when you do, you turn chicken. That's the argument. And if you affirm your ruling, you're part of the problem. You're part of the conspiracy. Next thing we know, you're getting emails from somebody, and you're part of the problem. That's simply not how the law works. Anybody who sat through 9 days of that hearing knows that is exactly not what happened and exactly not what this record shows. Now let's talk about this numbers game for a minute. You remember testimony where Mr. Chance came at the hearing and said, well, the time it would take me in a day to send all these sexy emails at 3 seconds apiece times 21, la, 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 la. You know, trying to play these numbers games over and over. Telling you, well, you only sustained 3 of the 12 findings in the report. Hold on a second. It's not a numbers game, and even the Superior Court says it's not a pure numbers game. It's an analysis of what? Whether the reasons proffered for the termination were pretextual, meaning made up, false, not to be believed. What this board did was it allowed 9 days of hearing on the investigation, on these peripheral issues, considered all of it, and went point by point and found that there were violations, not just 3 violations and 3 partial ones. It found that there were repeated, knowing violations of a policy despite several warnings, reiterations, memos, communications, etc., etc. That whole analysis is exactly what the board was doing in evaluating pretext. This isn't a situation where a report springs forth and says, you parked your car in the wrong place, you took an extra 15 minutes for lunch, and you didn't wear a tie when you were supposed to. And then these other 9 are all just nonsense. I hate to do it, but you know, your findings were of this ilk. Confirm Mr. Chance continually used county cell phone, computer equipment, and systems during working hours for personal use. Extensive time was expended communicating with girlfriend via phone and emails containing sexually explicit contact. Other personal emails to another individual includes profane language. Looking through all that record, what this board found, this finding is sustained. This board even went to the level of saying, when it partially sustained things, it identified, well, would this be one that would be legitimate for termination or not? Why would you do that? If somebody's saying, I didn't violate that policy, and then you prove you did, why would you evaluate whether certain ones are proven violated, and certain ones are proven violated but not appropriate for termination, and certain ones didn't have persuasive evidence? Why would the board engage in that? Pretext. That's the reason you're doing it. You're saying this reason standing alone wouldn't be grounds for termination. This finding is sustained. And most importantly, I love it when lawyers get up in front of a board and say, the great common sense saying, two wrongs don't make a right, you know, something that's stood up since Aesop's fables, is bunk. And you're supposed to look at Forrester versus so-and-so. All right, two wrongs don't make a right. It's something that you can put on a bumper sticker, burn into a wood board, hang over your bed, no place like home, things like that. Your common sense is exactly what guided you. Your common sense is what caused you individual members of the board to cross-examine at length people about things like, you did a sloppy investigation. Well, people who violate policy are sometimes found to have been subject to a sloppy investigation. You know, remember what we're talking about here. We're talking about someone whose approach to this was first to deny knowledge of the policy, then admit knowledge of the policy. But when he's caught in his own testimony that he admitted he dropped the ball with the policy, he says, well, the policy's ambiguous. But when he's shown that he knew the policy and had it, he has to say, well, yeah, I guess that was explained. But when evidence is shown to document proof that he knew the policy and it was explained to him, he says, well, the policy's invalid. And then he says it's not an important policy. And then the fallback to all of that is pretext. This board was presented all of that evidence and properly evaluated.
Your whole case is pretext. How can someone with a straight face argue that your whole case is pretext comes from a board that did not consider pretext? The Superior Court doesn't say that. What the Superior Court says at the end of it is, you need to make rulings that show your consideration of that, and he cautions, Mr. Chance faces a high evidentiary bar to prevail. Effectively, this record is complete. This record was properly evaluated. What is sought here is a clarification, because as you might guess, after this board and then the Superior Court are lumped into the conspiracy against Mr. Chance, the Court of Appeals and maybe the Supreme Court are going to look at this record, and the Superior Court has a duty to say, let's make sure the record is complete. Just like the hearing officer reopening the record today for these additional emails, let's make sure the record is complete. Leave it to the fact finder to determine what they say. What those records show is really that it was just more of the same. Is it something that I, as the county's attorney, am proud that people are emailing back and forth and making these offhand comments? No, but you know, I'm not here about changing human nature. I'm not here about any of that, and neither are you. What you're here about is the record that was given to us something that supports pretext, a very limited issue. It's important for you to consider multiple, repeated, ongoing violations of policy, and that's exactly what this board did before. This board did not dull its pen in criticizing the county in terms of its investigation. This board did not dull its pen in trying to eviscerate witnesses who gave improper testimony or acted on improper motives. This board limited the evidence in no way. I've never been overruled so many times in my life as I was at this hearing. All that evidence came in, and are we to believe that y'all just found the one document that showed, oh yeah, I admitted that, I dropped the ball, and you said, let's not just read the rest of that? Mr. Chaffman said he wasn't there when you were deliberating. I wasn't either, but I suspect it wasn't anything like that. Certainly the hearing wasn't anything like that. This record supports the decision that was made, and the best evidence of that comes from who? Commissioner Bell. If this whole thing is a trumped up, ambiguous policy, nonsense prattle set out to ruin this man's career, Officer Bell would have said, I thought it was a travesty, the whole thing was a sham, and we shouldn't have done anything about it. He doesn't say that. He said there should have been some discipline. He acknowledged that it was a significant problem for a department head to repeatedly violate policy. He simply disagreed that he should have been terminated because of it. Well, guess what? When you get five people in one room, especially in a political body, there's a good chance they might not have unanimity on all things. Lack of unanimity is not pretext. Well, what they did have unanimity on was that there should have been some discipline. What Mr. Chaffness told you is if you find there was anything pretextual about any of the motives, you should reinstate Mr. Chaffness. There's no evidence that supports reinstatement in this record. The only evidence in the record that supports bad blood is that there was bad blood, and that Brant Meadows, in this board's opinion, by filing the ethics complaint, acted improperly. He was not his supervisor, he was not the decision maker. The Board of Commissioners, by majority rule, and only one of them was cross-examined by Mr. Chaffness. The others are just being attributed this ill motive because they received an email. Well, what's sauce for goose is sauce for the gander. Oh wait, that's an old saying. Maybe I shouldn't use that because the law doesn't recognize common sense. But the bottom line here is this gentleman was found to have violated policy that significantly undermined the workings of the county. Any feelings we have about the Open Records Act being overused or too broad, those are things we should submit to the legislature. Those are things that we should vote on. But it's not anything that is appropriate here other than exactly what this board did. Remember the quote I read you, hearing Officer Miles said, if the motives for the email open records request were improper, we're going to let that evidence in. All of the evidence was put in, and this board, an experienced board that knows what a case of pretext is, has been advised about what it is, heard it at least two or three times a day during a 9-day hearing, knows how to evaluate pretext. What this remand says to this board is the board should basically look at the record and do this. The county submits there are three relatively simple things that are required under these circumstances. One, this board should reiterate that it did in fact consider and address the issue of pretext in reaching its detailed and exhaustive ruling in December.
This board should reemphasize that it did not take lightly its obligation to look at the evidence as to each individual violation alleged, and that's reflected in the long ruling of this board and the long hearing we held, and determine where and when the evidence did or did not support those allegations, something that you've already done. It is important to note that this board determined that Mr. Chance had violated county policies, each carrying possible termination as a discipline, and many of them multiple times despite admitted knowledge of the policy and reiteration of that policy to him. This board specified that in its ruling already, the insubordination, using your word, the lack of respect in your estimation. Those things should simply be reiterated. Mr. Chaffness has commented on the weakness of this board's two wrongs don't make a right finding. In Mr. Chance's case, it's an estimated, I counted them, 106 wrongs not making a right. Mr. Chance's case is one where any suggestion that was pretext was far outweighed by the evidence that was considered. In your ruling, importantly, this board specifically considered the very thing that would be part of pretext. At the end, what this board said is, it evaluated similarly situated employees. The board said the only similarly situated employees who committed similar policy violations were Kennard, Watkins, as development director, and it went through what disciplines those people received and why the different discipline here was appropriate. That's part and parcel of what you're doing in terms of pretext. That evidence was allowed, it was not restricted. The fact that he didn't put more in, that was his burden to show that those things were pretextual. And this board addressed that. So what this board is to do, the county submits, is show that it gave full weight to arguments and evidence with regard to pretext and effectively ruled that the evidence didn't support a finding of pretext. That evidence is already in the record. It's voluminous. It's been fully considered. I will not insult your intelligence by going through chapter and verse of it again. You have tomes of transcript that you can re-refer to. You have your own ruling that specifies that in detail. This board should not be misled by the ever-changing efforts being made to champion the current reviewing body while demonizing the one before it. Mr. Chaffness has attempted to demonize the county staff, the county attorney, and the board of commissioners to this body. Don't be misled. This board will suffer the same wrath if you don't fall in line behind the arguments that Mr. Chance has made, despite the significant record of violations of the policy by this individual. What this board, there's a quote in here about running down rabbit trails. I would submit that this board should not take the invitation to run down rabbit trails with regard to one email or one comment that was made. In fact, this board has already gone through the exercise of allowing evidence on every rabbit trail. And when they got to the Warren, what they found was a policy violation by Mr. Chance, and they upheld termination. This board has had the courage and legitimacy all along to allow evidence, to consider it, and the courage to say enough is enough in the face of changes of charges that this board doesn't embrace, that if this board doesn't embrace Mr. Chance's position, the board itself is lacking in integrity and legitimacy. In this case, by his own tongue, by his own word, Mr. Chance dropped the ball as a department head. He suffered the consequences. The county submits this board should not drop the ball by reversing its well-reasoned and long evaluation of the evidence.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Buckley. You have 17 minutes.